Hi, you're listening to What's New Today. This is your host Sangeeta from India. And on this podcast channel, I usually chat with children about current events shaping our world. But we're taking a short break from that theme for 5 episodes. And we cover stories that are not current, but a part of our history. These are stories of the queens who've ruled India. This episode is part 2 of this series. In the previous episode, I discussed the story of the only queen who defied Aurangzeb successfully. Her name is Keladi Chennamma. In today's episode, I speak about Noor Jahan, the de facto ruler of the Mughal Empire. She ruled from behind the curtain for 16 long years at a time when the Mughal Empire was perhaps the richest in the entire world. Joining me in this episode to discuss the life of Noor Jahan is...
Hi, I'm Isabel Abraham. I'm about to be 11 and I live in Mumbai and I study in Children's Academy Group of Schools, Thakur Complex.
Hi, Isabel. Welcome back. I know it's your summer holidays and you've done a little bit of reading about the Queen Noor Jahan, but have you been up to anything else more interesting beyond reading about Noor Jahan?
Well, I have been writing a little poetry to sharpen my vocabulary and I have been catching up on more worldly affairs.
Worldly affairs. Okay, there's one tuk-tuk sound coming. Yeah. Are you trying to beat the laptop?
I think the neighbor just opened the door.
The neighbor opened the door and I can hear that. Wow.
It's very loud here.
Can you hear when the neighbor, the kids in your neighbor's house fight?
When they shout or scream or talk loudly, yes.
Everything you can hear. What fun, what joy. All right. So you were speaking about you catching up on worldly affairs. Is that what you said?
Yeah. I recently read about Amitabh Bachchan winning an award for his contribution to Indian acting. So this award is named after Lata Mangeshkar. I didn't even know that there's such an award.
Neither did I, if it makes any difference to you. I didn't know such an award existed. But have you seen Amitabh Bachchan movies?
A good amount of them.
Oh, wow. Which is your favorite?
Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gham. I suppose you've seen it?
A little bit. In bits and pieces, I have seen it. You've seen the whole movie?
Yes. Like 2-3 times.
Wow. You're a big fan of full-blown Bollywood drama with all the music.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I heard a cuckoo sound. Is that also from your neighbor's house?
No, that is from my house.
That is from your house. All right. Okay. Now we'll get back to the topic of Noor Jahan. But how about we start discussing Noor Jahan through a series of games. So the game is called Two Truths and a Lie. Have you heard of this game called Two Truths and a Lie?
I have heard of it, but I have not played it.
That's fine. We'll play it together. It's a lot of fun. I'm going to be breaking the whole story of Noor Jahan into 4 parts. Now, in each part, I will make 3 statements, out of which 2 of them are true and 1 is a lie. And I know you've done a little bit of reading about Noor Jahan. So you might be able to tell me which one of them is a lie.
Okay.
Before we sort of jump into the game, do you want to tell our listeners, you know, where all you've come across the stories of Noor Jahan? Did you find them in your school textbooks?
No, actually, when I searched in my old textbooks and my recent ones, there's not even a single mention about such a queen, Noor Jahan.
Okay.
I find that very sad because she's an amazing role model to look up to.
Okay, so where else did you find information about her when I told you this was the topic and we're going to be recording a podcast on it?
Well, I did search a bit on Google and Wikipedia and all these websites. So that's where I mostly found my information from.
All right. So let's see how thorough Google and Wikipedia have been for our nearly 11-year-old Isabel. All right. So we'll start part 1 of Noor Jahan's life. So this is sort of the very beginning, early part of her life. Okay. Here are the 3 statements. Tell me which of them is the lie. Statement 1, she was born in a royal palace. Statement 2, her parents adored her and gave her a great education in books and art. Statement 3, Agra was then the capital of the Mughal Empire, and she was born outside of Agra.
The first statement is a lie.
Absolutely right. Do you want to tell us what the truth is?
She was born in a hill called Kandahar.
Kandahar is a town, a city.
Kandahar.
Yeah, it's in modern day Afghanistan. So she was born on the roadside, not inside a palace or, in the lap of luxury. Do you know the story surrounding her birth? Why she was born there?
Not much, but I do know that her birth was surely very difficult because she was born on a roadside.
Here's the story in short. So her father was a very well-read man who was reasonably well off, and they used to live in a kingdom called Persia, which is modern-day Iran. But I think her father fell out of favor with the king at that point in time. He disagreed with him. Plus, her father had collected a lot of debt, so he had to pay them off, and he didn't have the money. So he was fleeing persecution. He left Persia with his wife, and I think he already had a couple of kids. Nurjahan's mother was pregnant when they were fleeing, and they were traveling en route through Afghanistan. That was when Nurjahan was born to her mom. So that is why she was not born in some nice little palace or mansion, but on the roadside. The other two statements, therefore, are obviously true. Agra was the capital of Mughals, and she was born outside of Agra for the reasons we've just established. And her parents adored her. Not too many girls who were born in the Mughal Empire got a great education in books and art. Girls who were born to reasonably well-educated parents who were somewhat well off, they got this great education. They had access to a lot of books. They could read, they could write, they could write poetry like Isabel. Even Nurjahan used to write poetry like you. Are you feeling a little bit of affinity?
Well, when I researched about her, I felt that she's like right next to me. She's a very interesting queen.
Yes, that she certainly was. And she was extraordinarily good in art. She could design a great many number of things, but including clothes and architecture.
I would like to share a fun fact with you that Noor Jahan designed this cloth called the Noor Mahali, which was very affordable at a rate of 25 rupees, so that even the poor people of her kingdom could afford to buy it. So this generated a lot of economy for her kingdom too.
Okay, very interesting that she did it for the sake of making fashion accessible to the middle class and the lower classes. That's very
Middle
interesting.
class.
Now we'll move to part two of her life. I'll give you three statements. Shall we see which of this is a
Yes.
lie? Statement number one, she married the Emperor Jahangir when she was a teenager. Statement two, she was taught to hunt. She could load guns and muskets. Statement three, she was able to follow what was going on in her country, all the administrative affairs of the kingdom through her letters with her father and her brother. Which of these three statements is a lie?
The first one, that she was married to Emperor Jahangir when she was a teen.
Absolutely right. Now please tell us the truth.
She was married to a Persian adventurer, Sher Afghan, when she was 17 years old.
You're right, she was married as a teenager. Her first marriage was not to the Emperor Jahangir. Her first marriage was to a soldier in his army. She was married off to this soldier, I think, at the age of 17. And
Yes.
she had moved to Bengal because that's where her husband was then serving the army, the Royal Army. He was reasonably senior in the army. And she actually learned to hunt tigers quite a bit when she was posted in Bengal, and her father was a very senior member in the kingdom. So that is why is statement number three true, that she was able to follow the affairs of the kingdom, was because her father was a very senior member.
Her father was a sort of advisor. We can't actually say advisor, but kind of that, to the king in that time. women weren't allowed to actually, you know, participate in the affairs of the kingdom. So that's why Noor Jahan had asked her father and one of her brothers to give her letters on what was going on.
Yeah, she got all updates, you know, through the letters her father would write to her. So her father was nearly the prime minister. Her brother was then serving in the army. He was still not very senior yet, but he was also serving the emperor. So the whole family was somewhat reasonably high up in the hierarchy. So they knew what was going on, what kind of policies the emperor was coming up with. And they wrote letters to Noor Jahan. He felt very close to his daughter and he wanted to always keep her abreast of what was going on in the kingdom. Now, any other trivia you came across, a fun fact in this part of her life?
Well, when she was married to Emperor Jahangir, many people would say that Noor Jahan is the real brains behind the throne. So she would often rule hand in hand with Emperor Jahangir, and that's why her kingdom was so wealthy and well off and popular. So that's one trivia I would like to share.
That's a trivia I'd like to share. Okay, but we have to come to this part after we uncover part three, you know, after she was married to Jahangir. Yeah,
so
we'll come
I'm
to that.
All ready for part three.
We should wrap up part two with what happened to her husband before we jump on to her marriage to Jahangir.
Her husband had died when her daughter was only 2 years old. Her daughter's name was Lajli Begum.
So her husband was killed, not in a battle, but he was suspected of going up against the emperor.
Like, he was sentenced to death.
So after that, Noor Jahan moved to Agra along with her daughter, Lajli Begum. At the age of 31, she had been widowed and she had moved to Agra. Now we come to part three, three statements.
Yes.
Statement one, coins were issued in her name in the Mughal Empire. No Mughal queen had ever had coins issued in her name. Statement 2, Noor Jahan married Jahangir at the age of 34, at which time she was the first and she remained the only wife of Jahangir. Statement 3, when noblemen used to come to Jahangir's court with a problem, say for example, how much to tax the peasants, the noblemen knew that to get the real answer, they would have to meet Noor Jahan also. Which of these three do you think is the lie?
The lie is that Noor Jahan was the first and only wife of Emperor Jahangir. So the truth is that she was actually the 20th and last wife of Emperor Jahangir.
Yes, absolutely. When Jahangir married Noor Jahan was 34 and he was, I think, in his 40s. But after that, he never married anybody else. He was deeply in love with Noor Jahan and that's how matters stayed. Now about the coins issue, do you know any trivia?
I have seen some pictures and on one side of the coin, Noor Jahan's name and royal position in the kingdom were inscribed. On the other side, Emperor Jahangir's name and royal position were inscribed in the same language. So this signifies that both of them would rule hand in hand.
In the Mughal Empire, Noor Jahan was the only queen in whose names coins were issued. But rulers elsewhere, of course, had had coins issued in their name, like say Queen Elizabeth I in England. That's why we call her as a queen who ruled. We don't call her as just a queen who sat on a throne next to a king. That's not who she was. She ruled in her own name. She had coins issued in her own name.
Mm-hmm. So, she was very innovative for her time. She made sure that trading was very easy for other countries by building proper roads, and she built many architectural marvels.
You're right. So, Noor Jahan conducted all foreign policy affairs for her country. Oh, but we're jumping ahead. Because there's still a part four of her life. Shall we finish that and then wrap up?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. Here are the three statements in part four of her life. Number one, the emperor Jahangir was once kidnapped by one of his trusted lieutenants. She rode on elephant back, raised an army, released Jahangir and got him back. Statement number two, all the coins that were issued in her name survive to this day, or at least most of them do. Statement number three, she designed a tomb for her father in Agra, which became the basis for one of the greatest seven wonders of the world.
I think the second statement is false.
The second statement was all the coins that were issued in her name as a co-sovereign survive to this day. And I mean, I don't know if it's all, but most of them.
I don't think so that that's true, because I've never seen a coin coming in her name.
Have you seen a coin in Akbar's name or Jahangir's name or Shah Jahan's name still
no.
there? In just in the natural course of life, some of these coins, as they keep losing value, you know, they would perish. So you are right. That statement is false. Coins in her name have not survived. Or very, very, very few of them survive. But there's a reason behind it. Did you come across any story?
No.
The story is, after Jahangir's death, the person who took over the kingdom was Shah Jahan. He ordered, soon after he ascended the throne, that all coins that were minted with Nur Jahan's name had to be returned to the treasury and they had to be melted. Using a coin with Nur Jahan's name was rendered illegal in the Mughal Empire.
I think the reason for Shah Jahan doing this was he was like afraid that his ideas and his opinions wouldn't be valued because of how extremely influential Nur Jahan is in the court, in the Mughal court.
Absolutely. In fact, right after Jahangir's death, Nur Jahan did not live in the royal palace in what's called the imperial harem. She lived very far away by herself because many people were so afraid that if she were allowed any communication with the army or senior members of the nobility, she would be capable of taking back power in her name.
So, she was actually placed under house arrest by Shah Jahan himself. After that, she lived a very quiet life. Like, she was not in contact with the Mughal emperor or anything.
100%. And now we'll wrap up with one of the greatest masterpieces Nur Jahan gifted the world. I started talking about this tomb that she had designed for her father. Her father, it's called the Tomb of Itmadullah. It is in Agra. Do you know what masterpiece was built based on the tomb she designed for her father?
I think it's the Taj Mahal in Agra. The reason I said this was because I know that Shah Jahan, he had copied many of the things from many other tombs, not just Nur Jahan's father's tomb. He has taken the designs and the kind of material, the stone used to build one significant and beautiful masterpiece, which we now know as the Taj Mahal.
Yes, if you visit Agra, you can visit what's called the Baby Taj, which is the tomb of Itmadullah. I don't know if Shah Jahan copied the tomb from that, but he definitely copied the use of the white marbles. The idea that you can use white marbles for this tomb was something that Nur Jahan started when she built her father's tomb. And if you visit the Taj Mahal, right, you can see that the marble is inlaid with precious gems, which means you'll find tiny little gems, you know, sort of studded between the marble stones. So the idea of inlaying a precious gem and how to do it and how to design it was something that Nur Jahan started. So if you visit Agra, you may want to also visit the Baby Taj. And with that, we come to an end of this episode on Nur Jahan, the queen who ruled one of the richest empires of the world from behind the curtain. The two books that I refer to as part of my research material for this episode were The Women Who Ruled India by Archana Garodia Gupta and The Anarchy by William Dalrymple. Join me next Friday for part 3 of this podcast series, the story of another queen through a series of a different set of games that I'll play with my young co-hosts. If you haven't heard the story of Keladi Chennamma in part 1 of this series, now is a good time to scroll down and get started.
If you'd like to find links to all the blogs and the videos and the books that I've referred to, I've left links to all of these in the show notes below. I'll see you in our next episode. Till then, goodbye from me, Sangeeta, and from my young co-host.
Bye-bye.